Hey, film friends, welcome to Furman on Film. I'm Nick Furman, but you knew that already, where we bring you movie reviews and insightful written deep dives with little hints of comedy and even some sketches. Today, we're beginning a new segment in order to get you more of the content you want to see and hear. We're going to be delivering you weekly podcast-style discussions with my close friends who think they know more about movies than I do. In this case, I think he's right. So, without further ado, this is JT Mollner's Strange Darling. Okay, guys, today I have a very special guest. He's a world-renowned cinephile and an eminent board game aficionado, which he'll tell you about in a second. He has his own channel called The Trip Advisor. That's two T's, don't forget that. And he'd rather be watching a Terrence Malick picture than anything Marvel has ever produced. My favorite, JT, it's Jason Tripp. Welcome, man. Welcome to the
Hey,
channel.
man. Thanks. I am honored to be a guest on the first ever Furman on Film sort of expanded cinematic universe, I guess we can call this.
That's right.
I think the only true thing you said in my intro there was that I'd rather be watching a Malick flick than an MCU. I don't know if world renowned is that's quite the statement there, but we share a love of films, and I think we share a love of this film we're going to discuss today. So happy to be here. I'm a JT as well, so it's kind of fitting we're discussing this film by director JT Mollner, Strange Darlings. So why don't we dive in? Can I just talk a little bit about my viewing experience maybe? And I think I was the first one to get to the theater, and I let you and some of our mutual friends that I'm sure you'll have on the show as well. And I was like, guys, you got to watch this film. And I'm not the horror sort of thriller gory movie gore like you. So the fact that this one was compelling to me is high praise, I think. So
This one kind of snuck up on me, man. I was gonna say, I think the first I heard of it was from you, and it was an article, I think it was an IndieWire, right? That was like, guys, Giovanni Ribisi is back. But now he's a cinematographer and he's awesome at it. And it was like kind of breaking that stuff down. So I don't know, just maybe you could just take us through that, like reading about the film, your viewing experience. We can talk about loosely. At first, we're going to get into spoilers a little later, but just loosely what the story is all about, that kind of thing.
Yeah, I read an article over at IndieWire, I guess,
I
in
think that's right.
August, about a month ago, when it was just coming to theaters, and just saying that, basically this is the best American horror film in years, which was pretty high praise. And I was like, okay, I mean, I pick my horror films very particularly, but then I read, okay, Ribisi behind the camera, non-linear storytelling. I didn't want to learn too much, but okay, I'm like, I'm hooked. Okay, I'm gonna go see this. So I had some time. It was an afternoon screening, popped into my theater. I'm literally sitting down in my seat with my popcorn when boom, chapter three comes on the screen. I'm like, okay, it's gonna be one of these movies.
Yeah, that's right. Mixed up stories, mixed up
Mixed
chat.
up story. And something else comes on the screen. It says, this film was shot in 35 millimeter. I'm like, oh. And I literally audibly groaned and rolled my eyes. I'm like, really? You're gonna start your film by like putting that up front? Like, that's very pretentious. I'm like, okay, this better be damn good if you're gonna show me that in the title card. 5 minutes later, I'm like, okay, I'm in. Because it literally thrusts you into this story, sort of mid-story, chapter three. There's six chapters and an epilogue. And where we start with chapter three, I think the title of chapter three is Can You Help Me, Please? And we just see the slow motion, this girl in sort of this red jumpsuit, like she's an escaped convict
That's right.
with blood rushing down the side
Straight
of her
from your head.
face. She's inflicted a wound. And then there's a dude in a truck snorting coke with a rifle, wearing pretty much what I'm wearing today.
That's right, man. Dude,
Um,
you
and,
cosplay.
and,
You nailed it.
and in Canada, we call this affectionately, we call this Canadian tuxedo.
That's
This is
right.
like, this is our formal wear here in Canada. So yeah, and he's snorting coke. He's got a rifle and he's chasing her down. And, his name is the demon and her name is the lady in this film. And you're like, okay, I knew going in this was a serial killer story, so I'm like, damn, okay, this is like we're right in it. The serial killer is just chasing this lady down for some reason. We don't know why, we don't know where. We're just thrust right into the action. And I'm like, okay, I'm in. Like I'm on the edge of my seat. There's no preamble, there's nothing. You're just going. And as she's running in slow motion, the song Love Hurts is
That's
just
right.
playing in the background, right? I'm like, oh man, I'm in. Like within the first 5 minutes, I'm like, there's some sick shots here. There's some amazing sound design, and this is going to be this cat and mouse two-hander. And I'm like, okay, this is compelling stuff. I'm in. And then it just goes from there. So, long story short, this was probably in like top three or four like cinema going experiences for me on 2020. I mean, this side of Dune Part Two, which is its own animal in my case, this is incredible. Incredible viewing experience. So we'll get into the plot points and details, but just my general thoughts were this was one of the hidden gems and big surprises of the year for me so far.
Right on, man. Just to like tee up on some of the things you were saying, I just think, like when you announced that your film's in 35 millimeter, like it pissed some people off, you know, like we've listened to pods where people have
Yeah.
gotten upset because it's like, don't announce, you just do it. Like Nolan doesn't put that in the beginning of his films. He just
Right.
films and then demands that you go see him on the biggest screen possible. So, but so then the question becomes like, do they back it up? And it's I well, like we've you should say even before she's running, there's this black and white car shot, remember?
Right. Yes.
And there she's it's a girl in the front seat, and we don't know who this girl is because we're watching this position of a man sort of shot in black and white, and she's like, are you a serial killer? And then it quick flashes to what looks like some sort of bondage sexual shot of like a guy choking a girl or something. I mean, you don't see the whole thing. And then boom, it flashes to like what you said. So, and then also there's an opening, I think it's a voiceover where they're talking about that there was this was the last days of this killing spree between 2018 and 2020 involving all this sort of stuff.
Yeah, in the Pacific Northwest and Oregon and surrounding area. Yeah.
So yeah, I mean, just you know, the introduction of the black and white. I don't know, like what else can we say about the cinematography? Like I mean, it's such a like a film bro thing to say, but it's just always creative and always moving. So I mean, I'm jumping out of turn, but to me, the closing long take of this film is just like insane, man. Like you're just
Yeah.
the very.
Well, I feel justified if we jump around because the movie does likewise,
Ah, there we
right?
go.
So there we
Permission
go.
granted. Yeah.
But yeah, Ribisi, let's talk about him because I mean, other podcasts we listen to, I mean, they ask the question, who won the movie, right? Like in this movie, who? And for me, the performances are compelling, the direction's solid, but it's Ribisi. This is the cinematographer that wins this movie, and like you said, he's back. And he's a competent actor. He's fine as an actor, but I think he's f found his sweet spot here behind the camera. So I'm really looking forward to what he continues to do. I mean, he has a potential to be one of the best, I think, DPs based on what I'm seeing here in a small sample size. The cinematography is incredible. The lighting is just amazing. The use of lighting and color schemes in this, and that's my Terrence Malick love coming out here. But there's a scene with the two important characters in a hotel and motel and talking in a car before they go in, and we'll get to that. And just the shadows and the lighting and that scene, the use of red and blues is pretty incredible. And even that opening scene, I mean, the chase scene, it starts with chapter three and they're just running through the forest. And I like a cinematographer who knows when to have, up close and personal shots and when to sort of back off and give us sort of aerial wide shots. And Ribisi does that pretty seamlessly here. I call that Sicario is another movie where I like to think about that. It's kind of a voyeuristic technique. So you get up and close almost to the point where it's so uncomfortable, and then they sort of back off, give you a moment of respite, and then all of a sudden you're back up close and personal. I found that used very effectively here, that sort of voyeuristic cinematography technique here that he uses. So yeah, the colors, the shots, the wides, the close-ups. I mean, he's in his bag here. And so at the beginning I was rolling my eyes when I saw that on the screen, 35 mil. By the end I'm like, okay, like yeah, all right, you've earned it.
And I think because this film is like, it's not gory all the way through, but there are moments of viscerality and like
Yeah.
where when he goes up close in that early shot, and the girl, I mean, it's like there's like a flap of skin on her ear, and
Yeah.
it's a pretty nasty
There's some
moment.
gnarly stuff here for sure.
Yeah,
Yeah.
but it's like that shot, the way he captures it is just sort of heightens it in a great way. So, yeah, I mean, I always say, well, I mean, a lot of times sound design and production design or cinematography, they kind of seamlessly go together, right? I mean, I think people that don't break this stuff apart like we do, you feel it, you see it, you feel it, and it's like if the movie kind of resonates and vibes with you, usually those things are kind of like working together in tandem. So, like I made a joke, I don't, to me the sound design of this movie is great. I was like, it sounds like a 90-minute Godspeed You Black Emperor record. There's just like all of this stuff kind of going. Like sometimes it's big, sometimes it's small, but it's just really it's like I described it as like constant and immersive. Like that's, I don't know, that's just my sense. Do you have any other like feedback on it? Or, I mean, or I just, yeah.
Yeah, the I mean the cinematography and the sound design are sort of walking in lockstep, and
Right.
they do go hand in hand. I mean, it's like a good pie and ice cream dessert. I mean, you can't have
Yeah.
one without the other.
Yeah.
And especially when, and we'll talk about the lead actors shortly, I'm sure, but when the demon Gallner's character is on screen, sometimes we just get this like this synth guitar sort of riff, this heavy
Oh, right.
droning sound.
Yeah,
Yeah.
that's what I'm talking about.
And
That's the Godspeed stuff. Yeah.
right, yeah, exactly. For those that don't know Godspeed, I mean that's what it is. And it's just like, and, you know, there are a couple, and I'm a bit of a lightweight when it comes to horror movies, so it's not hard to give me a good jump scare, but I think, I don't know, was it you saying that even there were a couple scenes that got you like kind of because of the cinematography and the sound design, it's just like boom, it's like
Yeah,
whoa, right up in your
there's
face.
one
Yeah.
that I jumped, man. Like not a
Yeah.
lot, but there's one that is, yeah.
Yeah. So I think it's used to good effect. It's not overused or misused or abused. Sometimes people can just overuse that stuff, but I think at the appropriate times and moments, and it adds, then the fact, and we'll get into this some more too, that it's a non-linear sort of
Yeah.
unveiling of the story coupled with the cinematography and the sound design. It's just a beautiful little cocktail of non-linear storytelling that really worked for me.
Yeah. So I think I wanted to, you know, I want to do some pros and cons, kind of get into the plot before, of course, guys, we're gonna give you our final our FOF ratings. We're gonna have two of them this time. I mean, we know we gotta do that, but what else you got? I like some other points about it. One of the things I wanted to mention is like I think it's funny in moments, like sort
Yeah.
of darkly so, but there's some really funny stuff. You made a good point not to mention. I like there's a cameo early in this film that you just go, what? These two are in this movie? Like it just blows you away. Some two longtime actors, not necessarily from the horror genre, and they just show up and you're like, okay, well then they're gonna be major, right? So
Yeah. One of my favorite scenes, I mean, what's spoil it. Yeah, we'll get into spoiler territory later. We'll let you
yeah.
know. But these two iconic actors, they're just making this Sunday brunch. And
Yeah,
it was one of my
exactly.
favorite scenes. I'm like, damn, I gotta up my Sunday brunch game. This is inspiring stuff here, right?
Yeah, dude. It becomes
Mean,
like
maybe not so for
more.
someone who runs Iron Man's like you, but for me, I'm
Yeah,
like, yeah, I like a good tasty high calorie Sunday brunch from time to time. But yeah.
he gets in there. It's like you're watching the Food Channel or something. It's
Yeah.
crazy.
Yeah, I'm like, what is this? The taste of things? Like, jeez. Yeah.
Yeah.
Well, can we talk? We got speaking. I mean, let's not forget the cameos. We got to talk about Willa Fitzgerald and Kyle Gallner a little
Yeah.
bit. I mean, these are probably two actors that aren't very well known. Are you familiar with some of their previous work, stuff they've been in?
Honestly, Gallner's in what's he in that I know? Willa Fitzgerald was totally new to me.
Okay.
There's a Gallner's in.
Well, they both had their, they both interestingly been in the Scream cinematic
Oh,
universe, I
right.
think.
Yeah.
Yeah. Gallner was in Smile.
Oh, Smile, that's it. That's the one I was thinking of.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Which I still haven't seen. Jennifer's Body, he was in that.
Oh, yeah, good. That's
I
a
think he was in American
film.
Sniper too,
Okay, that's
which,
right. That's probably,
yeah.
honestly, that's probably where the one I was thinking of, because he comes off kind of like a military grunt, which
Yeah.
I think is part of the whole, you
And I
know.
wonder if Mollner saw him in that movie when he thought of him
Yeah.
casting him in this role, perhaps. Yeah.
That's what I think, because I think the idea is to create this sort of lithe, damsel in distress being hunted by, the Canadian tux wearing, he kind of looked like a hoorah grunt, So, yeah, I think that's all part of the whole part of the setup. But I want to say, in terms of pros and cons, there's a cat and mouse game here. Like, that's kind of what the film gets into. And what's interesting about it is it's framed inside of what we would consider maybe one of the ultimate cats and mouses, which is in a sort of an erotic sexual role playing that is taking place between the lady and the demon. So, do you think maybe we should get in? You want to do into that? You want to get into the spoilers kind of now? Or, I mean, I think we hit. You got anything else you want to say before we tee that up? I don't want
Yeah,
to.
no, just kudos to both these actors. I think the fact that this is becoming kind of an indie cult classic and came out of nowhere. I think the budget for this was like 4 million or something, and it's doing quite well. I think this will be a springboard to bigger projects for both of these actors. Willa Fitzgerald in particular was pretty incredible in this. So kudos to her. There's not a ton of dialogue in the film, nor do I think there needs to be, which I appreciated. You don't need to have a bunch of exposition, right? You want to keep the audience sort of on their toes and a bit disoriented. And I think it's, but I mean, her range in this is pretty incredible because each of the chapters, as we get into spoilers, we'll see things twist and turn and morph, and things are not what maybe they appear. And it shows the range of both of these actors. And so I think they both do a great job, and it was kudos to the casting for bringing them in. So I think they both fit these roles perfectly.
Yeah, and they bounce off each other well too, because he's asked to play sort of this sort of in very internal, controlled guy, which you play at the seams of that as the movie goes on, where she is like just full emotional spectrum, right? She's supposed to be, and so I think the sort of juxtaposition of that is what gives the movie its nice flavor.
And kind of we're dancing around spoilers. I don't know how much longer we can
Let's
do
go.
that.
So
So,
if you don't want this movie spoiled,
and you
then
don't want this movie spoiled. Trust me, you don't want this movie
I
spoiled.
think to spoiler it, to spoiler it, to spoil it would be to ruin it to a certain extent. And we'll talk about that a little bit, honestly, too. But so we are going into behind the scenes, like in-depth spoilers right now. We need like a foghorn. All right, so
Spoiler alert.
yeah, no, I don't know that we need to break down. It'll take probably too long to break down each of these, but I do think you got to get into spoilers to talk about the ultimate like pros and cons of the movie. So, you got it. Like, yeah, go ahead, fire away, man. Like, what do you
Can
got?
I just very briefly talk about the six sort of chapters and where they fall? Just sort of the general contours of the plot.
Yeah, I'm here for it.
So the movie starts with, like we said, chapter three, Can You Help Me, Please? And we see the demon in his truck. He's snorting cocaine to stay awake while he chases the
Oh,
lady in the
that's right.
stolen
I forgot about
car.
that. Yeah, that's right.
He blows out her rear windshield, he causes a wreck. Eventually she survives and stumbles into the woods and finds a nearby cabin. She knocks on the door and asks residents for help. Boom. That's all of
That's three.
chapter three in chronological order, but chapter one for us, the viewers.
Now that we're in spoilers, we should say the door that she knocks on is Ed Begley Jr. and Barbara Hershey. Like, just freaking perfect
It's
cameo.
amazing. Oh, it's incredible. It's
Just
incredible.
enjoying a Sunday breakfast as like this loving couple in the woods, like survivalists they appear to be. Anyway, go ahead.
So that happens first. But we've got, five other chapters in the film. So I'll just go through them chronologically and let you know where they fall in the runtime. So, chapter one, which doesn't come until sort of midway through the movie. And midway, that's where things sort of start to turn and we get to some more information that's helpful to understand who's who, what's up, what's going on. It's called Mr. Snuffle. Mr.
That's right.
Snuffle. And you alluded to this. It's chronologically the first thing to happen. And it's kind of a one-night stand between these two characters.
Who,
They're in a car. And so we get this awesome blue light shining through their windshield
dude.
there. I talked about the lighting.
Yes, the
They're
blue light is
flirting in the
so
car
cool.
outside, like a dingy motel. Eventually they head inside. We don't get this revealed until later in the chapter, but during this conversation, they kind of establish these rules for like this BDSM encounter, and
Right.
including a safe word. Hence the title of this chapter, Mr. Snuffle. But Mr. Snuffleupagus is the safe word that they have,
I
which is
forgot to give you that
hilarious.
word. Right when we started, I should have given you an out if we this got too intense tonight.
We forgot to pick our safe word here,
That's
but
right.
you let me know if this gets too intense. Yeah, Mr. Snuffle.
Right.
So yeah, we get that. That's part three. But during that part of the film, we kind of realize, okay, things aren't what they seem here.
Right.
Maybe there's more to these characters than we thought in the first chapter that we see, as we assume, okay, he is called the demon, he's the serial killer, she's going to be the next victim.
Right.
Just to let the cat out of the bag, I mean, there's another chapter called Do You Like to Party?
Yeah.
And then they're in the hotel and they're getting into it, right? Things are getting a little kinky, a little twisted between the two of them there. And at one point, I should say in the car, she flat out asks him, "Are you a serial killer?"
Right, which is a right, which is a teased in the very intro in the cold open, basically.
Right. And he says no. And then they go in, and then she pulls out some what we think is cocaine. Says, "Do you want some coke?"
Right.
And but she laces it with
It's
it's ketamine, right? It's
ketamine.
ketamine. So
Yep.
he's really messed up at that point. And then you realize, oh crap, she's the one that's got some nefarious intentions here, not him.
Right.
So she goes into the bathroom while he's taking what he thinks is cocaine, and she realizes, big reveal, in her wallet, she sees what?
He's a cop.
He's a cop. And
Yeah.
she's like, oh shit, what do I do now, right? Because super spoiler alert, he's not the serial killer, she's the
She,
serial
yeah,
killer. And at that's the
exactly.
point you realize, if you haven't already guessed that
Yeah.
point, sort of mid-movie, you're like, okay, things really turn on its head. And now you're like, okay, well, why was he chasing her? And then you
Right.
start to kind of put the pieces together here.
But I
I'll
think
take you
what,
in. I mean,
yeah, well, I was gonna say, like, I think what turns the film so well, at least when it's the initial reveal, is that it's all taking place inside of this sort of S&M game, because she's asking him to like choke her or like do these things, and then not like, so he's basically asking him to play a role, but then there's a part where it shows her freaking out. So you can never really tell if he's pushing it too far, because our brains have naturally decided he's the killer and she's the victim. Or when she finally, like, she says a safe word, then starts laughing, now she's finally turned on. But she's kind, so it's just this idea that like there's this dance going back and forth constantly, and it's a game of like cat and mouse and one-upsmanship, where you're trying to figure out when they're playing this role and when they're actually that. And that I think is the sweet spot of the film. Like, when it gets into that part, that's the best it gets, because then it's like, oh, he's actually chasing her, maybe because she's a freak and he's pissed off. But then it's also like, well, he's a cop, but he's snorting coke, so maybe he's unhinged himself. So we're still trying to like piece all this together. But like you said, man, we're getting it in like real time. So,
And
and
I
that
should say
way.
too, like before the whole hotel scene, there's another chapter. So you're probably messed up listening to this, but chapter three is first for us. And then it
Yeah.
goes to chapter five,
Right, which
is the
is him.
second scene for us, which is inside Begley Jr. and Hershey's
Yeah.
home,
Right.
where he's just sort of stalking her here,
With
kitty,
a
kitty,
rifle.
with a rifle, trying to figure
Yeah.
out if and where she's hiding out. And he's literally blowing holes in different potential hiding spots. So
Yeah, and
you're
isn't he saying
convinced
like
at this
here?
point, this guy's unhinged. This
Yeah,
guy
he's saying
is
like here, kitty,
sadistic, right?
kitty, and stuff. Like, isn't he like taunting her almost? I'm trying to remember.
I mean, this seems like the stereotypical sort of serial killer who's totally unhinged and just playing games with her. And so then from there we cut to the hotel and things start to fall into place.
And then, yeah, she carves in him, and then she runs, then the chase, and then,
She carves the initials EL
yeah, like
in
on the
his
plate.
chest, because the serial killer, we discover mid movie, the serial killer has been nicknamed the Electric Lady.
Yeah.
And she says, oh, this is the first time I've ever done it in someone's heart, right? So
Yeah.
But as he's he's stumbling, obviously taking his ketamine. The reason she gets that wound is because he's got his concealed weapon. He's able to, even in his disorientation, get a shot off, clips her in the side of the face, and then she stumbles out of the hotel, off some of the one of the employees, I think,
Yep.
gets the red jumpsuit, and then that's where we get to the opening scene. All that is then lead up to where we see her with that wound, sort of struggling to escape. But we know now how everything sort of led up to that point.
Yeah. And then, yeah, just to speed it on to its conclusion, I think so.
Sure.
It's just basically he finds her in the house, but then by then he's called two friends, like two cops, like I screwed this up. And then it kind of goes on to the conclusion. She somehow gets away, and then now we've got to finally dispense with her, and this little old lady comes to the rescue, and that's when you
Yeah.
get the final long take where we're basically just watching her die in a car seat for like a minute and a half, and it's so good, man. Like as I'm sorry, as it's slowly fading from color to black and white, right? So
Yeah.
you're like ascending back down to where the film started.
Yeah, it comes full circle there, and Ribisi's just showing off at this point. Yeah. Yeah, but
So
some of the meta narrative is interesting too. I mean, it's not a deep movie with deep, deep themes, but it kind of turns gender stereotypes on its head. I mean, part of the cat and mouse, part of the trick is, we're meant to assume that all serial killers are male, right? So obviously this guy's a serial killer, right? And even when the cops show up, right, she brilliantly is able to get out of the situation by, kind of pulling her pants half down. She's handcuffed, saying,
Thank you.
like, oh, he was chasing me, he was abusing me. And the female police officers, rightly so, very empathetic to that, and says, okay, we gotta get her to safety
Yeah,
here
she uses the gender stereotypes against the cop, essentially.
to her advantage.
So, I mean, I think, if you love this movie, it's probably because of the sound design, the mixed up plot, all this sort of stuff. I think we hit the pros. Like, what do you anticipate? People would be like, ugh, this wasn't for me, or the criticisms, or I think you and I have the same kind of cons of it. We perceive it maybe differently,
I
but we're on
mean,
the same wavelength.
I'm sure some people will, and probably already have, see this movie as all style and very little substance, where it's showy camera work and sound design, but at its core, it might be a little hollow thematically or with the characterization. And fair enough. I mean, it is what it is. It's meant to be a genre pick. It's not meant to be some deep philosophical Terrence Malick film, right? So there are some themes in it. So I've heard some criticisms too, where people think this is just a cheap ripoff of, I think this is the Tarantino pastiche, and
Yeah, the
I'll let
Tarantino.
you sort of expand on that. But I've heard that as well, and I get that it's a valid critique, but I think it's more homage than ripoff. I mean, Tarantino's whole shtick is he's paying homage to Sergio Leone and other famous directors that preceded him, right? Every director, you take your influences, but you give it your own spin. And I think that's what Mollner and Ribisi are doing here. So I don't think that's a really valid criticism. I see a lot of homage here and not cheap ripoffs. So what about
Yeah,
you?
I think, well, no, I agree. I mean, I think, look, on base value, if you put this film and you run it chronologically, it's still a really well-made film, but it's not nearly as interesting in terms of reveals and things like
Absolutely. It
that, right?
loses the suspense. Yeah.
Yeah, because by like the second minute that pretty early on that she's the one and he's kind of stuck and all this sort of stuff. But like as you were saying right before we press record, I mean, I think that the film is crafted with that in mind.
Sure, that's part of the screenplay design from day one, or close to it, I imagine. Yeah.
So I guess my biggest issue is that I wanted it to lean into the cat and mouse stuff even more
Yeah.
because of the whole like sexual role playing stuff. They could have kept playing that forward because once the film kind of teases or kind of reveals to you that it was her, it never really goes back on that. And I thought it would be really cool if it was like she freaked, and then all of a sudden it's like, wow, maybe this dude really is unhinged and is chasing her. Like it could have kept going with it, and it kind of just gives you the reveal and then keeps doing the time thing, but we kind of figure out what's going on pretty early on. That would be my biggest like dig. And I think that's probably partially by design because, like you said, it's a fairly bare bones story, right? So
Sure.
because I think Mollner wants everything to be sort of heightened with immediacy. But yeah, that would have been my, if there's a way to write it so that we're still even unsure what he's got to do with it. Like, we know he's pissed off enough to shoot this chick, but is she really who she says? I think. But then again, you lose the serial killer element. So I don't know. All in all, I think it's a pretty powerful flick. I get the Tarantino pastiche dig because no one is Tarantino. But Tarantino also hasn't made like a bare bone serial killer flick. So, or has,
True.
I don't think he has. So, like, cool, man. Do the homage thing. Do it. But if you're gonna do it, at least do it well. And they did. So that's how I.
Yeah, at the end of the day, for me, those are minor quibbles, and there's a lot more to celebrate than there is to nitpick with this film, and hence here we are singing its praises for the most part, right?
Yeah, and I don't think he needed to necessarily put about the 35 millimeter, but Mollner himself has gone back and said, like, well, no, like it drew attention to the fact that we shoot on film, not digital. And if
It's
more
a
people.
celebration of that, right? We want that to
Exactly.
be preserved in a digital age, like,
Yeah. And
some
if.
of his influences. Yeah.
Yeah. And
Yeah.
he, exactly. And he said, like, that's, he thought he was more paying homage. And some people have come to him and given him feedback that, like, it teased them up to want to do it themselves. Well, then, like,
Exactly.
more power
So
to you. Like,
I'm sure he's happy to take the criticism if it leads to more people celebrating and using that methodology to make films like this. So, yeah.
so, all right. So now I think we've hit it, man. I don't think there's anything else. I thought maybe we could give kind of our final scores, what we our FOF rating. So I'm gonna let you go first. This is a cool little thing. We hadn't pre-discussed this. So where are you at with this one?
Yeah, and I love that for FOF, it's not like three and a half. You could like it could be like 4.123 if you want, right? Like, but bear in mind, like for me, a movie like this, these are not my typical go-to movies, not my typical go-to genre. I'm the guy who likes more slower paced international films like Terrence Malick, right? Something that is a little more maybe emotional depth to it. But that being said, this was one of the surprises of the year for me. I will go back and rewatch this film. This will be my Shocktober shortlist every year. I'm not a huge Shocktober guy like you guys, but I give this a 4.1, which is
Ooh.
very high praise for a movie of this genre from my perspective. So, loved a lot about this film.
So I wrote down when I was doing this, I wrote down 4.1 question mark,
Really?
4.2 question mark.
Ah,
And I
okay.
was
All
right
right.
between those and trying to figure it out. I think, well, you know what? Since it's horror, I'll lean in and I'll give it the 4.2, I guess. I'll
There
give
you
it the
go.
4.2.
There you go. Combined rating 4.15. There
That's
we
right,
go.
4.15. Actually, that's really where I'm at. So, but that's,
Perfect.
man, without us like previously discussing, that's
Wow.
kind of where we
Nice.
landed. So, yeah, man, that's it. Strange Darling turned out to be a strange darling. Like we really have found some affection for this one. So I think it could show up on our year-end lists, which, we're going to be making videos as we get closer to Oscar season and all that stuff. So, yeah, man, I think that's about all I got. Or you have any closing thoughts, or you want to tease
No,
up? I got about four.
yeah, like we're getting into that Shocktober season. If you haven't seen Strange Darling, I think it's available VOD or very soon, if not already. So be sure and check this one out. Dim the lights, put some headphones on, even for the sound design. Find the biggest screen possible, and just soak it in. It's a wild ride from start to finish. So,
Give me your.
Furman, thanks for the invitation. It's been great to hang out. I hope we get to do this again.
Yeah, give us like a 30-second, some things where they can find you, check you out, some things you're working on.
Yeah, so during the pandemic, I started a YouTube channel called Trip Advisor, which is sadly been a little dormant these days, but I got a new project I've been leaning into with a friend. It's a collaborative project. It's called Dice Camera Action. We basically
Nice.
just dropped our first podcast on Spotify. We're going to expand to Apple and YouTube channel as well. So my friend Matt here, we're both in Sudbury, Ontario, Canada. We're both movie fans, but we're also fans of tabletop board games. And so it's kind of a mashup podcast where each week we'll share a little bit about what we've been watching, what we've been playing. We'll do a sort of a deep dive review of a tabletop board game, and we'll pair it with a film with some thematic overlap. So we'll timestamp all that. If you're not into the board games, you just want to get the movie reviews, you're welcome to
Yeah.
wander over there. Or maybe if you're into tabletop games as well, you can check it out. It's called Dice Camera Action, and we'll be rolling out episodes every couple weeks. They'll be sort of 90 to 120 minute episodes. So
Awesome. Dice Camera Action. So check that out, guys. You can check out my website, furmanonfilm.com. If you're not following our channel on YouTube or subscribed, please do that. We're gonna keep bringing this stuff. We got live behind the scenes video reviews coming up. Probably some more like comic sketches, these video reviews that are short, 6 or 7 minutes about single movies, and now this podcast style stuff. So we're really excited about where we're going. Thanks for being my first guest, bro. I appreciate it. So
Can I say this, the magical words?
you can do it. Do it.
This is Jason Tripp, special guest, along with Nick Furman, Furman on Film. Stay firm,
Stay
my
firm, my
friends.
friends. We'll see ya.